I started my professional career as a large animal veterinarian, taking care of dairy cows. I graduated from University of Pennsylvania Vet School in 1978, when there were very few women practitioners in large animal practice. And I believe I may have been the only woman large animal practitioner in the entire state of Utah, which was the only place I could find a position after graduation. The Mormon dairyman called me the Lady Cow Vet. I hope when and if my Lady Cow Vet memoir gets published, you can read all about that adventure. But this is not the time to talk about that part of my career. After 5 years in practice, I came back to Cornell. I completed my PhD in reproductive physiology in the vet school. And then I took a job at Merck in their R&D group. After about 10 years of working in the pharmaceutical industry, developing both human and animal drugs, I quit and I was on my own. This is the story of what happened next. I'm going to tell you of my two companies. And I hope you may be inspired by the fact that even someone like me with absolutely no business training could manage to succeed, although bearing some scar tissue. The original idea was simple. There are a variety of human medical advances that could be used to benefit animals. And this fact presents business opportunities. After all, as we know, dogs get cancer too, and cats get kidney disease. I'm sure you can think of a long list of medical conditions shared by humans and animals for which there are human therapeutics, but nothing approved specifically for animals. Academic researchers in veterinary medicine and R&D groups in industry understand this, but there's still little interest in putting significant resources into building startup animal health companies or investing in animal health drug development. At least there weren't back in 2001. The revolution that created the biotech industry had almost completely passed veterinary medicine by. In 2001, I co-founded Elchira Bio with the tagline, expanding the market for advances in biotechnology. The idea was to help human biotech companies understand the value of their intellectual property when applied to animal health. Then I thought I could help the human biotech companies license the technology to one of the major animal health companies. And I got together with a friend who had years of experience in marketing and animal health. And with my knowledge of R&D, we had the credentials and the knowledge. All we had to do, we thought, was identify the companies with human drugs or technologies that might work for animals. For example, drugs for lymphoma or pain or diabetes. We expected that they would be delighted to use our help to license their technologies for a few million dollars of non-dilutive capital. We worked out of our home offices and vowed we'd never complicate our lives by having employees or borrowing money. Luckily, we did hire a lawyer, became an LLC, and drew up an agreement laying out the terms of our partnership. This turned out to be key as we grew the business because we had clarity and transparency around our roles, responsibilities, and ownership. One of my friends experienced in business told me not to skimp on the legal costs. And that was excellent advice. We started out by cold calling human biotech companies, going to big biotech meetings. I spent hours trolling the internet for ideas, studying biotech companies' technologies, reading supporting literature. But to our surprise, vanishingly few companies were interested. Animal health was the lowly stepsister of medicine. It didn't get attention or resources that human pharmaceutical development did. Everyone in the drug development world was interested in that billion-dollar drug. But there were no billion-dollar drugs in animal health. There were vanishingly few innovative medical interventions for pets or farm animals that were approved for animal use. In fact, if biotech companies mentioned that their shiny new drug could be used for animal health, it was assumed by investment bankers and venture capitalists that this meant it was a failure for human health, and the company was looking for some way to salvage a bit of value from it. So we made our business consulting on regulatory affairs, market evaluations, experimental design. We made a decent living and continued knocking on biotech doors, hoping to find a willing client. Finally, one company liked our idea, and we were able to take their technology, develop a plan, and help them execute a few key experiments, and then partner the opportunity with Fort Dodge Animal Health for a payment of $5 million. So even with this success under our belt, it was clear that biotechnology companies just didn't get what we were trying to do. Our glass was truly full, half hot air, and half only one example of success of our original business idea. What happened next? We evolved. We were maniac networkers. We went to major biotech companies and animal health meetings. We became busy with various types of consulting and finally decided to hire an admin, and our billable hours went up 30%. And then a real breakthrough, an Australian company asked us to run a full drug development program for a drug they had approved for dogs in Australia. They wanted to get approval in the EU and the US. And I said, sure, we can do that. Again, a change in direction, but in the right direction. This launched us on a new trajectory as we planned the pivotal clinical trial for the Australian product and charted its regulatory path. Now our business morphed into a company that could run clinical trials in veterinary clinics all over the country. We got additional contracts doing major clinical trials for animal health companies, hired more staff, and we grew our business. This was a long way from our original idea. We dropped the expanding the market for advances in biotechnology and became just Elchira Bio, the contract research group. Although not at all planned, it became clear that this was the growth opportunity of the business, and we went for it. More and more focusing our resources on clinical trials. We employed about 20 people, we expanded the office space, and became highly profitable. Where we started and where we ended up, who could have predicted? Now, here is where I might have benefited from some business savvy or some investor money. We were working harder and harder, but the expenses were greater and greater, and our profits were not growing with the company. Burned out, I was ready to wind down, fire our employees, and retire. But we had the good sense to talk to some business advisors who pointed out that our company had a lot of value and we could sell it. Seems obvious now, but at the time, I was really surprised. We hired a firm that did mergers and acquisitions to help us value the business, and in 2008, we sold the company to Argenta, a New Zealand company that manufactured animal health drugs. How did we find Argenta? The founder was an old friend of ours from Mariel days. Another example of how important your network is. Of course, the first thing the new owner does is change the logo. My partner and I were asked to stay on to transition the company to the new owners, and the pressure was off, thankfully. After a year of working to transition Elchira Bio and phasing out, I was approached to consult on an innovative new idea hatched by a major East Coast venture capital group, MPM Capital. Frustrated with poor returns in human biotech, they had an idea. You guessed it, expanding the market for biotechnology. They paid me to consult with them as they developed their business plan. And this was a case not of a founder looking for funding, but in a way of funding with an idea looking for a founder. We found a couple of exciting molecules at a Japanese human biotech company, and MPM recruited another venture group, Avalon Ventures, to co-invest for a total of $25 million. And then MPM invited me to Boston and offered me the position of CEO. I was stupefied. On my way to retirement, it seemed crazy to take on the challenge of growing another company. But how could I turn it down? This was my old idea made real. I was in, and Aratana Therapeutics was born. We started with two drugs that were in development for humans and two people, myself and the COO. We grew the company at a furious pace. And when an IPO looked like the possible next step, I asked to be the CSO, and one of the venture guys became the CEO. We raised over $200 million and we went public in 2013. So much for retirement. Aratana grew to over 70 employees, opened an office in Kansas City, licensed in additional technology from human health. And as I said, we raised over $200 million. And in 5 years, we achieved FDA approval for Grapapront, also known as Galliprant, for canine osteoarthritis pain. It's also been approved now in the European Union. Capromorelin, which is known as Entice, for appetite stimulation in dogs, and bupivacaine liposomal formulation, Nocita, for post-surgical pain. I retired in 2016, and the company was subsequently acquired by Elanco. Soon after, the other program we had started, Capromorelin for weight gain in cats with chronic kidney disease, achieved approval with the trade name Allura, and you should see that launch in the next couple of months. This year, Argenta was acquired by a private equity group, KKR and Company, for about $100 million. Between these two companies, there have been over 100 excellent jobs created, which really warms my heart. We were pioneers, and now there are several successful animal health biotech companies and startups. So the big picture, working for yourself with your own ideas is extremely fulfilling. Never say never, no employees. Be willing to pivot when conditions change, be nimble. Know your skills, let someone else lead or manage the money if you are not good at it. Know when to step aside. And finally, timing and luck play a big role in success. And finally, the risk is worth it.